My name is Torsten Norgaard. I'm a Danish photographer. I travel the world taking photographs and teaching photography. Today I'll tell about how an artist works and how an artist builds an archive. So today's talk is a little bit different than usual because it's not just about photography, it's about being an artist. And it is like a sideshow, it's a side product of, for the last few weeks I've been doing the Photographer's Workflow Masterclass on how to build an archive as a photographer and how to do your whole workflow, edit your photos and so on. And part of that is relevant also for all artists, and that is how do you produce and how do you build an archive so you have a bigger and bigger volume of, you could say, products on the shelves that you can sell. That takes building an archive, and that's what I'm going to talk about today. A renaissance is coming, and what does that mean? Well, a renaissance is a renewed interest in something. So throughout the last few years, we had like a build-up of first watching television and laughing when they did something fun on television. Now we have so-called interactive media, and we tend to set up the interactive media like Facebook, Instagram, and our software, our computers and our devices, to set them up with automatic responses. So suddenly they're like kind of like running our life. And one of the things that happen is that you have a phone and then it tells you now you should read, or now you should read 20 pages to do this, or you should go on Facebook because somebody made a comment. So your whole life gets busy doing this and it feels very active. And you could say you get a lot of traffic, you get a lot of comments, you get a lot of likes, and it seems fulfilling. It seems like it's important. But fundamentally nothing really comes out of it. It's just wasting your time. So you basically become the machine that responds to commands. And that's not how it should be if you're an artist. If you're an artist, you should basically isolate yourself and work on your ideas. So whatever comes to mind, that's what you put out to the world. You don't put out to the world what Facebook asks you about or Instagram thinks that you should do. So that's the whole essence of being an artist, and that's what we need. We need somebody who can think for themselves and who can create things and who have ideas. And if you're one of them, then your assignment is to produce something and put it into an archive and put it out in the world. But first thing is to produce and build an archive. So let's talk about that. So what is an archive? Well, you have to build an archive, and an archive is simply just that you put things in a place so they're easy to find again. So you write, if you write poetry, you have to put it in a place so it's organized, you can find the poetry you're looking for when you need to publish a book or you want to do a reading or a compilation of some kind. That's an archive. If you're a photographer, that means that you have, today you have your pictures digitized, so you have them on a hard drive. So they have to have keywords and stuff so you can find them again, and you also have to have a system so they're backed up so they don't get lost. So that is an archive. Archive is not a new concept, it's not something I just came up with. Archive have been around for many thousands of years. One type of archive is a library, and that's been around for like 5,000-6,000 years, that you make a collection of books and you put them on shelves in alphabetical order and subjects and stuff. So when you need to read how to build a floor in a house, you can find a book about it. That's an archive. Also, photo archives exist where you store pictures like back when it was film and print, so you can find the negatives again, you can find the photographs and so on. That is an archive, and it's fairly simple, but it's very important to have. Sometimes you will hear that being an artist is not a real job. That's not true. Being an artist is a real job, and that's why you have to work at it and attack it like it is a real job. You have to produce something and you have to put it in an archive and you have to put it out so it can be exchanged and sold, you get paid for it. The great thing about being an artist, apart from that you get to decide when you want to work and how you want to work and what you want to work with, is also that the genius of being an artist is that you make something once and you sell it many times. So you make, for example, a song, and it can get played millions of times, it can be recorded in different versions, it's still your song and you get paid each time it gets played. And just let's take a song like Hey Jude by McCartney and Lennon. Just a piece of paper is written on it, it's like a 5-minute thing to do that song. And that song had made millions, but even just a piece of paper it was written on was sold for $910,000 just recently. So that gives you an idea that being an artist can be really well paid. You look around at Beyonce and you look at Elton John, you look at different people, you look at Spielberg, they make good money being artists. So that is a real job, but you have to produce something. Here's a great thing: if you're young and you're watching this video, then the great thing is you don't have to be experienced to be a great artist. You actually don't even need an education. What you have as an artist is that you have ideas and you're bright and you can think different than other people. You can come up with stuff and you come up with stuff continually and you get great ideas. And that is what makes you an artist. If you look at some of the successful artists, if you take, for example, Bob Dylan, who is quite old now, but he had his breakthrough in the 60s and 70s, the 1970s and 1960s. He wrote some amazing songs when he was really young. In a recent interview, the interviewer asked him, how did you write the songs, for example, on the Freewheeling album? And Bob Dylan says, I don't know, I just did. And I know I can't do it today. Today I do something different and I do things different. I cannot do the same thing again. So that's one little detail. It means that if you are young and you're waiting for a breakthrough and you think when you get your breakthrough, then you will start making your art. No, that's wrong. You have to make your art now while you have the flame and you have the clarity of mind and the ideas, and you have to put it down because that could be some of the most valuable art you ever do. I don't say it has to be, but it will be valuable. Anything you do and you put down on a piece of paper is going to be valuable. Another example in photography is Henrik Tepperson. He took his masterpiece. Henrik Tepperson is considered the street photographer or the reportage photographer of the century, meaning the last 100 years. He has a great catalog, maybe of 250, 350 photographs that keep circulating in books, posters, and everywhere. But the really iconic photos he took when he was 21, 19, and so on, when he was really enthusiastic about photography and he didn't have a lot of experience. So you don't have to have education or experience to make something that is great. So the sooner you start, just get going. You don't have to wait for anything. There's a great chance that you think that you are unique or different. You don't actually really fit in. I talked to a lot of really great artists that had a great career, and basically all of them said that when they were like school children or even younger, they felt they were different. They didn't fit in. They felt they were unique. They felt they had something to contribute, that had a meaning with their life. They had to do something, and they hadn't quite found out yet. And then suddenly they stumble into it. They stumble into painting or photography or writing or something, and then or singing. And that's how they found out that's what I was supposed to do. So that also means that if you're young, or even if you're in your 20s or in your 30s or 40s, you might not fit in. Other people do other things. I mean, they sit on their devices and like one photo after the other, or they watch television, or they go drink, or they do drugs, or they do like this and they do that, or they go sail on boats. And you don't, because you actually sit and get ideas and you put them down on paper. So it's almost like if you're an artist and you're a teenager, it would be very natural that you actually sit home and feel very different. And you also feel a little bit alone because everybody else is partying and doing something that seems interesting and valuable, and that's the thing, the hip thing to do. And you don't really fit in there because you're an artist, you're making something. So what you are making as an artist is what they're going to be looking at in the future, what future children, young people and adults are going to look at, and it's going to make them happy, it's going to bring them hope and life. That's what you do. It also means, and you can say that's a natural, it's kind of like difficult how you do this, because you want to be hip and you want to be like the others, you want to follow the group or what looks like the important thing to do, and you want to go fit into the university because that's what you're supposed to do. No, as an artist, you have unique ideas, so you are different. And it means that you're going to sit home, you're not going to be doing drugs, you're not going to do crazy things, you're not going to be drunk and stuff like that. You're going to be sober, a good girl or boy and just make your art. And that's going to feel weird, but that is what you're supposed to do. The great thing about being a good artist is that later in life, everybody else is going to look up to you and think, how could you do this? Because they were partying and drinking and doing drugs and stuff like that. So they didn't think about anything. They didn't make any original thought. They were just liking on Instagram and drinking beers and doing drugs. So they didn't actually originate any original thought. So building an archive is like, if you imagine you're an inventor, you invent a new light bulb, then you have to put it in production in a factory, and then you put them in stock, so you have a whole warehouse full of light bulbs, and then you get them into distribution through Walgreens or Target or something, or Amazon, and then you're going to sell 1,000 light bulbs a day or 5,000 light bulbs a day, and that's how you make money. So as an artist, you almost do the same. You're going to have to make your own poetry factory, or photography factory, or song factory, or whatever. You're going to produce things. So once you get an idea to something, you're going to put it down on paper or put it somewhere, so it's actually a thing that can be distributed and looked at or listened to and sold, and that's how you're going to get paid. The bad thing or the wrong thing to do is if you think that I'm just going to sit here and one day I'm going to be famous and millions of people are going to know me and then I'm going to start showing them what I can do. That's too late. You have to start now before anybody have heard of you, know about you, or regard you as anything. That's when you put your things down on paper. And this thing I say, make it once, use it many times or sell it many times. That's what you do. You make something on a piece of paper here and then it can be made into a song. It can be read aloud. It can be printed again and again and can be quoted. That's the great thing about being an artist, that you actually don't have to make 100,000 songs to have 100,000 songs played. You just have to make one song and it can be played 100,000 of times or millions of times. It's fantastic. You should think everybody will be doing this, but they're not, because they don't have unique ideas. So what I do to produce is I take photographs. So I travel around the world, I take photographs. So I actually always wear a camera. So I'm always looking for photographs. I'm always ready to take a photograph. It doesn't mean I take photographs all the time, because I also have the rule. If I walk around in a city like Paris or Rome or Istanbul, if I don't feel like photographing, I'm not going to take any photographs, but I have the camera with me. So once, when I see something that makes sense, I take it instantly. And I follow my intuition. So when I feel that something, I'm going to take the photo. I'm not going to think about if it's a good idea or not. I'm going to take it, because I know already that that's how I make great photographs. If I wait and think about maybe it's not a great idea, the photo is going to be gone. So I have to do it immediately. So if you're a photographer, you should wear a camera. If you're a composer, you should compose music. If you're a writer, you should write stories or lyrics or poetry or what, or books or whatever it is that you want to write. And that means if you're a writer, you have to wear pen and paper. You cannot write anything if you don't have pen and paper. Then you say, now it's a little bit different. When I was young, we had typewriters like this. I just got one again. Today we have computers. So what I will do is I will often sit in an airplane or somewhere and I'll have an idea to a chapter in a book, because I also write books. I write a lot of books about inspiration and photography and life and so on. So I always have like four or five books I'm working on and projects. So I'll sit in an airplane, I get an idea, oh, I should do a chapter about this, or I should tell something about this. And I'll actually put it into notes on my phone, the whole thing. If I have my computer, I might use my computer. If I don't have any of that, I might use a piece of paper. What I always do is that I take my notes and I put them into the computer at some point. So I might do them on paper, but I know I have to have them on computer. And I have a system. So I will, for example, put in my notes that this is for the portrait book, or this is for the composition book. And some notes I just have an idea, this could be a great article. I don't know where to put it yet. If it's going to be an article, maybe it's going to be an article and a book. But one of the things I do is that I make chapters. So when I write books, I make chapters. I don't try to write a whole book, 450 or 800 pages from the beginning to end. I deal in chapters. So I have one chapter about fill light, which is a thing you use in photography. So we'll have an article, how do you make fill light? What is fill light? And why is it gray? And why, what color should it be? And all this. All the things that it should be about fill light, I'll do a chapter about that. But the thing I know is that if I get an idea to write this, I'm not just going to write a note and say article or fill light, gold, silver, so that's like four words, because I know if I look at that note 4 hours later or 2 months later, I cannot remember what was the idea. So whatever idea I have that, wow, this is a story, I should tell this, I'll write the whole chapter in my notes on my phone. So even I have this small keyboard, I'll write it, and I'm going to have spelling errors and all kinds of stuff. It doesn't matter. The whole concept, the whole idea have to be there, because that means later I can take it, I can just edit it, remove the typos and spelling errors, and I can add and remove a little bit, but the whole idea, the whole thought is there, it's ready to use. Then what I do, let me just keep talking about books, because what I do with books is that I'll write chapters. And once I start actually making the book, when I have enough chapters on my computer, in my notebook, on my phone, I'll start putting it together as a book. Very often I'm actually going to work in Words on the computer, so I'll have my computer with me and sit, write one chapter at a time. I don't really care about the sequence because I'm working chapters. So it's bits, it's almost like Lego bricks, and then later I'm going to fit them together. So what I do at one point, I go on the computer and then I have set up the whole book with pictures, text and everything, or you could say each chapter. And it might be 450 or 500 pages. And what I do then is I print it out, the whole book, I go to UPS or somewhere and just have it printed out, and then I take the chapters and put them, sometimes I put them all over the floor, and I see what is the sequence of this. This chapter should be over here, this section should be about portrait, this should be about light, this should be like this, so these chapters fits in here. And I look at this, okay, that's fine, and then I put it together again as a book. Then I go back to the computer and then I change the sequence on the computer that now the chapters in my document on the computer is going to be the same as what I just did on the print. Then when I've done that, then sometimes I might read through it on the computer and change a few things and check for spelling errors. And then when I'm ready, when I'm done with that, then I will make a whole print of the book. And I actually have one of my books here is the portrait book. And this is basically the best part of being a writer, is when I print out, this one is 450 pages, so it's two chunks here. So I'll just put on these. And what I'll do is I'll find a good chair or a cafe or somewhere, and I'll just sit and read my own book as if I was the final reader. And then I'll make notes in it. And I'll see, oh, I should have a picture illustrating this, or I should do this. And once I've done this, and this can take up to a few days, then I'll go back to the computer and I'll type in the things I have written here, and then mark here, okay, this was done, and then I'll take the next page, the next page, the next page. When I'm done with that, I'm basically done with the book. And then I will send the document to my spell checker. So he will go through the whole book and he will check the spell checking, that spelling is right. And when I get it back again, then I'm going to check, is the pictures right, is there no white lines or something missing or something moved around. And when I'm done with that, I basically have a book that is ready to send out. And very often I'll actually pre-sell my books. I will have hundreds of thousands of people who bought the book before it's actually available. And then I send it out, and then the sale goes up. And the great thing about books is that they just keep selling. I mean, I made it once and that took some work and some time, but now it's done and it's out there and it's handling itself. I can do something else. And that's the awesome thing about any type of art, is that you just have to make it once and you can sell it many times. I also have notebooks. I really like notebooks. But let me tell you how I usually work. There's a survey that was done that shows that writers, the biggest problem being a writer is that you get disturbed all the time. That you have people gonna talk to you, and you're just in a train of thought that you have some ideas, you need to put them down, and then somebody comes to talk to you about garden work or something like that. And then you forget the whole plot. You're like, okay, so now you start over again. So finding time to being an artist, that's actually really interesting. I'll have days where I get up in the morning and I have to deal with emails or some other stuff, and maybe it gets 2 o'clock in the afternoon. I'm actually stressed out because I haven't produced anything yet. I've just been doing normal work. But me as an artist, my work is to just sit, look out in the air and get some ideas and put them down on paper when I write, or it is to walk around with a camera and look like I'm doing nothing and make photographs. That's my work. So I have to allow myself to do that. I travel a lot. I travel more than 25 countries a year. So for example, if I go to Rome, I'll rent an apartment for the workshop and my work I'm doing there for a few days. But one of the things I do is I'll get up in the morning, I'll go to some fancy hotel nearby and have breakfast. So what I really like, I like that it's aesthetic, and often it can be outdoors. I can sit and drink coffee and smoke cigarettes, and I can work on my computer or my notebook. So I have lots of people around me, lots of beautiful aesthetics, but I don't have to talk to anybody. They're not my friend, they don't know me, I don't know them, we don't have anything to talk about, but I just have this background of real life. So that's an ideal working situation for me. I'll have other places like hotels where I can go down in the garden. If I stayed, I go down in the garden and sit by a table and work on my computer in the morning. In LA, when I used to live in Hollywood, I would have a big terrace. I'd go out early in the morning and sit and work on my terrace for a couple of hours. Then I would take a shower and then I'd go up to one of the nearby hotels or Soho House, which is a private club. And I would sit by a table and work on my books or articles or whatever I was doing. So I have, again, lots of people around. There's food, it's aesthetic, it's interesting. You get to meet some interesting people that you don't have to talk to. Sometimes you meet somebody you want to talk to, but generally you're actually left alone. It's like a big obvious landscape, but you don't have to talk or do anything with other people. That's my ideal, and that's how I usually work. But I deliberately go somewhere and spill 2 or 3 or 4 hours not having anything to do other than just see what do I want to create today. And that's how you make stuff. This notebook, I really like notebooks. This notebook is the one I used to write the book I just showed you before, the portrait book. So instead of writing on a computer, I'm going to take this notebook, I'm going to write the chapters in this one. So I did, and then when I typed them into the computer after, I would just mark this one have been put into the computer, because of course it has to end up in the computer at some point. The great thing about this notebook, actually what I wanted to see is like, how does it make my writing or the book different if I do it in a notebook? And I actually cannot see the difference if I write on a computer in a notebook. What is different is that when I use a notebook, I don't need batteries, I don't need cables, I don't need a keyboard or anything, I just need the notebook and a pen. And even if I get the pen, I can borrow a pen from somebody, but I usually have my own pen. And, you know, I'll go travel somewhere, be in Nuremberg or somewhere, and then I have to get some food in the evening after I've done a workshop, so I'll take my notebook and go down to an Indian restaurant, and I'll sit outside, and while I wait for the food I ordered, and also after I eat the food, I can write 1 or 2 chapters. And when you get into a notebook, the whole world disappears around you. So it's just you and your ideas you put down on the paper. And the great thing is that a notebook doesn't give any notifications. There's no emails to check on it or anything. There's no pop-ups. It's just you and your ideas that you put in a notebook. So I really like notebooks. I think it is easier today to put into a computer instantly because it's digitized and you can search for it and it's ready to use for something, and it's basically already in an archive if you have organized it right. So the takeaway from this video is that archive is not so difficult to build. It means, you could say, if you want to have a system for it, then it is like find a space to work in where nobody disturbs you and you can actually think for yourself and you can create stuff, and either you can record it, you can put it down on paper, or you can photograph it. Whatever your art is, you have to have the space so you can actually make it. When you make it, you have to finalize it. So that means that you have to finalize a chapter, you have to finalize a poem, or even if you made notes that later you put it together, like 3 or 4 notes into one song or something, you have to finish each part of that. So it's somewhere you can find it again, and you at some point can sit down and maybe you have 50 different parts and you need to find four or five that can make up one song, you have to have that foundation. But that means every time you get an idea, you put it down. There's famous writers and directors that will have a notepad next to the bed because they know they wake up in the middle of the night and they have an idea. And if they don't write it down, it's gone. They can't remember it next morning. So they have a piece of paper next to the bed so they can just write down the idea, and then they have a system for that so that they can actually read it next day and they know what they mean. Like, what was the idea I had? It's on the paper. So you get the picture. You have to make things that are ready to be used. That is what it means to produce and build an archive. And that's how you make art. Art is not about being famous or look good. You have to make something also. You can look good and be famous and rich and everything, but the foundation for it is that you make something that is valuable and interesting, and you have actually made it and you have it ready to ship it out. That's all I have to say today. I hope you enjoyed this. If you go below the video, you can of course make comments, but you can also, there's a link to my website, overgaard.dk, so you can sign up for my mailing list, you can get a free ebook, and also on my website, you can easily find my email. You can always email me if you have questions, ideas, or comments, and I always read them. I might not answer within 5 or 10 minutes, but I do read it, and I usually answer all my email. Thank you for watching, and see you next time. Thank you.